This afternoon's panel is called Nuclear Innovation, Bright Ideas to Keep the Lights On. To stimulate our panelists on new developments for the future of the global nuclear industry, we have Marc Brouillette, who is a partner with the Secor Group, a strategy and transformation consultancy. And I want to take a minute to thank Secor for their sponsorship of yesterday's workshop talking about radiation. Marc focuses on industry analysis and restructuring strategy and the development of business models for emerging opportunities. He specializes in the creation of public-private multi-stakeholder business models and the negotiation of the associated contract relationships involving domestic and international stakeholders. His expertise spans across several industry sectors, including aerospace, utilities, healthcare, gaming, and telecommunications. Prior to joining Secor in January 2008, Marc was the principal consultant for Strategic Gaming Innovations and a manager within the strategy and transformation practice at Capgemini. While in those roles, he led the development of strategy and business innovation in the charitable gaming sector for clients in Ontario, British Columbia, Quebec, and Nova Scotia. And prior to his career in strategy consulting, he helped develop and negotiate the international agreements defining Canada's contribution to the International Space Station program. So this promises to be a lively discussion, and I'm going to turn it over to Marc and let him introduce the panel. Go ahead, Marc.
Okay, thank you very much, Marc. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the session. And to start things off, I'd like to introduce you to this afternoon's panel. So over to my left is Michael Lees. He's the president of Babcock and Wilcox Nuclear Energy, Inc., an operating group of the Babcock and Wilcox Company, which is headquartered in Charlotte, North Carolina. BW Nuclear Energy serves the global commercial nuclear power industry with a broad portfolio of reactor components, nuclear design engineering, plant construction, inspection services, and nuclear plant maintenance services. Mr. Lees is also the president of Babcock and Wilcox Canada, which is headquartered in Cambridge, Ontario. And prior being named to his current positions, Mr. Lees was Director of Business Development and Marketing at BW Canada. In this role, he had overall responsibility for identifying and securing new business opportunities. Previous positions included his appointment as General Manager for the Nuclear Steam Generators and Components, where he managed BW Canada's nuclear equipment business. Mr. Lees serves on the Board of Directors and the Finance Committee for the Canadian Nuclear Association and is a past recipient of the Ian McCrae Award. Between Mr. Lees and myself is Robert Prince, the CEO of Hyperion Power Generation. Mr. Prince has over 40 years in the nuclear industry and is a former CEO of Duratec Inc., a leading radioactive waste transportation treatment and disposition firm. Under his leadership at Duratec, the company grew from $7 million to $300 million in revenue when it was acquired in 2006 by Energy Solutions. He drove the commercialization of several technologies to better handle radioactive materials, including a vitrification technology that has been embraced by the U.S. Department of Energy. Before Duratec, Mr. Prince was the founder and CEO of General Technical Services, a wholly owned subsidiary of General Physics Corporation, whose business was to provide support to the services to the nuclear power industry. That was acquired by Duratec in 1990. Prior to GTS, he was an engineer with Gilbert Commonwealth, where he spent 9 years on a wide range of nuclear power projects in Europe, Latin America, Mexico, and the USA. Mr. Prince is a former member of the Board of Directors of the Nuclear Energy Institute and currently serves on several boards of directors of Aquachem, Thermofiber, MHF Services, and Curion, which is a technology startup serving the nuclear industry. In 2004, he was conferred an honorary PhD in commercial science from the Catholic University of America for his pioneering initiatives in commercializing radioactive waste vitrification technologies. Thank you, Robert. And to my right is General Fusion CEO, Doug Richardson. Mr. Richardson is an innovative technology leader who is highly skilled and experienced at developing and commercializing novel and unproven technologies. He has a history of formulating a clear vision, establishing a strategic direction, and successfully developing challenging projects under demanding economic and time constraints. Prior to establishing General Fusion, Doug spent 14 years at Creo Products in Vancouver in various roles from systems engineer to director of business development. He led projects and groups that developed Creo Products' key technologies and delivered profitable businesses and products, Mr. Richardson holds 3 patents with 2 more pending. Okay, for me and my firm, founded in Quebec over 35 years ago, Secor is Canada's largest independent and international strategy consulting firm. We have offices in Montreal, Paris, Toronto, Vancouver, and New York, and recently acquired the international firm MDFC, who has brought significant global energy experience. Our energy practice spans across all offices, coast to coast in Canada, and our energy international team members have worked in 60 countries, including initiating, managing, and implementing major nuclear slash CANDU, hydropower, other renewable, and gas projects. In Ontario, we've been working primarily in nuclear over the past few years, and it has been a great pleasure to work with or get to know so many of you. With the CNA, our most recent efforts have been to support a study of Canada's nuclear science and technology ecosystem that is aimed to describe the roles of government, industry, and academia in Canada's nuclear sector. And through this work, it's become apparent to us that the innovation engine in this ecosystem represents a critical capability that can contribute to the future strength of Canada's nuclear sector. So improving the effectiveness of innovation in this ecosystem may be a goal that we all share. From our research into innovation in general, which we'll be capturing our upcoming book on Innovation Reinvented, we believe the sector through collaboration can have a bright future in keeping the lights on, theme of this panel. So we'll start this panel discussion now with some brief thoughts from each of these esteemed colleagues, followed by a discussion over 3 theme areas. And those 3 theme areas is, how does innovation relate to nuclear power? How does regulation affect innovation, talent acquisition, and scale? And we'll get into those in a few minutes. So prior to digging into each of these, I'd like to invite all the panelists to give their 2-minute version of what they think, where they think innovation is headed. Michael?
Thank you. What I did is I actually looked up innovation to see what the dictionary said. And what it says is that innovation is the introduction of something new. It's not a major development of a new product necessarily. It can be a wide range of things as long as it introduces something new. In the business world, I would probably change that definition a little bit to say the introduction of something new, which is better, because I can write my name backwards, which might be a bit of an innovation, but it really doesn't make anything better. And that's how we look at innovation within B&W. We have the very, very large projects, which are largely major developments. The small modular reactor is a multi-year, hundreds of millions of dollars of cost associated with it, so a major project that taxes the entire corporation. The other end of the spectrum might be just how we organize a function. An innovative way of putting together people to take advantage of skill sets that they might have, but it's something new and it's something different and it's something that makes it better. So I look forward to the discussion today, and I'll be happy to share with you any ideas that I have on innovation and how I think it works and how I think it can be successful. And I look forward to hearing ideas from the rest of the panel members as well. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Mr. Prince, what do you think?
Thanks. Well, you spent a long time talking about my background, but the one thing you didn't say is when I was back with Gilbert Commonwealth in about 1981, I was on one of the best projects of my entire life. It was in Argentina, working on the CANDU reactor that they were then building. And now I see that you're going back to 30 years later for the first refurbishment. So we must have done okay because it lasted. I was the CEO of Duratec, and I was very fortunate to be involved in innovation and growing the company. And we were acquired, so I was retired in 2006. And I had a really good time. I woodworked, I rode bikes, I hiked, I kayaked, and I was really enjoying myself. And I was down in Naples, Florida at our winter home down there, and the phone kept ringing. And it was this headhunter that was representing a venture capital firm out of Denver. And they said, we have this investment in a unique small reactor, 25 megawatts electric. And the technology comes out of Los Alamos National Laboratory, and it's struggling to get through the commercialization process. And we're looking around the country for people that have been through that in a regulatory environment. And they happened on me, and they just kept coming back. And I told my wife, well, you know, nuclear power is the way to go. Nuclear power is the way to go. Something would come up on the press about wind or solar or Solyndra, and you can imagine what my remarks were. And so I said, well, I'll at least look into this. And so I got together with a bunch of people smarter than me, and we started to look at the technology and the science behind it. And we said, you know, it is good science. And they made good choices, but they've got a long ways to go. They need to introduce really solid engineers, and they need to develop the entire concept. And more important, they got to get it licensed in a country that's credible. And to me, that means Canada, the United States, or the UK. So we set about trying to build some credibility, add new staff, and set a set of goals, objectives, and a direction for the company. And a year later, I'm sitting here. Well, and there's a really good reason why I'm sitting in Canada. And I'll tell you about it as we go along. But I think that, you know, if you look at innovation, this is a Gen 4 reactor. The International Atomic Energy Agency actually calls it a nuclear battery because it's less than 50 megawatts. I like that title. It lasts 10 years, no refueling. It's a sealed unit. It's transportable. You bring it out to the site. You plug it in. It's in a vault. And 10 years later, you either take it away. Wait, really, you leave it for a couple to solidify. And it's lead bismuth, which is solidified at atmospheric pressure. So what the scientists at Los Alamos did effectively was look at the physics. How do you take that step jump in safety? Well, maybe you look at, do we want to have a motive force to spew radioactive material around the environment and just keep building containments around it? Or do we want to see if we can work at atmospheric pressure? And of course, most of the work in the world has been done on the smaller you go, the more you need liquid metal, right? And of course, it uses fast neutrons, so it's easier to control. There was just a lot of interesting and attractive things about it, none of which matters if the economics didn't work. And so what we looked at is the marketplace that they were trying to go after, and we said it really has a cost advantage only against large diesel generators in remote locations. It's about half the price. So can we focus this, and can we get partners to help us grow it? Because you certainly don't want to stand up an NSSS supplier. You can't. You heard Westinghouse talk about what they've got. You know, there's a reason that takes 100 years to build. And so the key is get good partners, good teammates, and bring an innovation through the network of regulations. And that's enough.
There you go. Thank you, Bob. Okay, and Doug?
Okay, so most of you are probably not familiar with general fusion, so I'm going to give a bit of background on that. And it is fusion, not fission, so I'm not misspeaking. And contrary to what Kate said earlier, fusion and even innovation can happen in this industry by a single person in a garage. General Fusion was founded by a character in a garage in Bowen Island, which is a small island off the coast of Vancouver. And what he decided in his life is what he wanted to do was solve the world's energy crisis. And he's a guy that I know very well, and he's exceptionally talented as a prototype person. And his background, with his PhD in plasma physics, is in fusion, specifically laser fusion. So what he did is he sat down and looked at all the sort of energy sources in the world and quickly concluded that fusion was the one that made the most sense. And then he went through all of them and decided what he could do as a private company. General Fusion is actually privately funded, so we're not in the public domain from government financing, which makes it exceptionally challenging. It also constrains what you can do, which means you cannot do billion-dollar projects. You have to limit yourself to tens of millions of dollars because you have to raise the money. So we discovered a technology out of the US from the Naval Research Labs called magnetized target fusion. There's a particular project in 1976 that had all these really nice economic things for a power plant, how to get the heat out, how to rebreed your fuel, how to protect the walls from neutron damage, embrittlement, and such things. The only problem in 1976, it didn't work. So the key innovation, what we did, was look at how can we fix the problems and why it didn't work back in 1976 by applying modern technologies. And this is a key aspect. There's many things that used to be impossible, which are now possible, and that's General Fusion's main thing. We're funded to the tune of about $32 million in private capital. We do have some money from SDDC, which is here in Canada. We have a $14 million grant from them. It's milestone-based, so we have taken in about $6 million of money as we hit our milestones. Our goal is to demonstrate fusion in a reactor configuration at scale, which means gain, more energy out than in 3 years, and to demonstrate it as a proof of principle from a physics point of view at full scale sometime this summer. So this is moving exceptionally rapidly. We're 60 people. We're located in Vancouver, and I think this is possible. In order to raise the private money, we had to go external. Canada does not have a fusion program. It's the only G8 nation that doesn't. So to get experts in fusion who understand what we're doing, we had to go to the US and Europe. But the verifications came back positive, and every scientific person who's looked at it says, okay, you know what? It's possible. They won't say it will work. We don't even say it will work. But it's possible to work, and the amount of dollars to do so are very, very small. So from an innovation point of view, many different aspects. Small guy in the garage, private fusion company, not so many of those around, doing fusion in a country that doesn't actually have fusion anymore, and taking on multi-billion dollar type things, using some very clever thinking on how to change something that's there. And one of the key aspects for me on innovation is to lead. So you can do incremental sort of improvements following, but if you actually want to make something transformational, you really have to lead. And there's an aspect of innovation when you do that, that people call you crazy. So we've got that a lot, but it's going down. You can come visit us. We'll show you around the plant. We'll show you who's verified and how it's working. And maybe at the end of this coming year, we will be crazy. But maybe by the end of this year, it'll prove that we've changed sort of the global economic profile, both in energy and, you know, sort of wars and everything else to do with the oil. So.
Very good. Thank you very much. So as you can see, we have a wide variety of members up here on the panel that come with a significant number of different perspectives. And now we can start talking about, you know, the questions that we're going to have them weigh in on. So as we mentioned before, we have four questions, the first of which has to do with the innovation in the nuclear power sector, and more specifically around how effective is Canada's nuclear science and technology ecosystem in fostering innovation in our nuclear power sector. So how could this relationship be improved, and if so, how? And Michael, if you want to start with some comments on that.
Sure. My view, you know, it's very hard to measure success of any program. You can look at patents produced, you can look at products produced, new services, whatever it might be, but it is still very difficult. You know, my sense, if I compare Canada to other Western countries, it would seem that we are falling behind. There's no question about that. What I do see about our ecosystem, if you like, is that generally it focuses on not all the right things. Some of the right things, but not all the right things. It does focus on can-do, and perhaps that's not the right thing to focus on. Maybe it should be a broader view, a broader focus on different nuclear technologies. That's one thing. It does focus on product development. There's a lot more to innovation than product development. You can read books about how companies have reinvented themselves, not because of a product, but because of their management approach and something that they've changed. And you can get just as great an improvement by doing that than having a new product. So I don't think there's enough focus in that area. There is government support, and largely, again, it is on the development side of things, the actual development of a product or service. The other thing that's missing, I believe, is the commercialization. I think Canada has a very innovative culture within the technical groups, technical businesses, academia, etc. But what we're kind of poor at is commercializing that. And so if I was to identify an additional need or improvement, it would be for some help in determining the best approach to commercializing this product, and not just here in Canada, but globally as well. So I guess in summary on that particular topic, I would say that we're good, but we could be a lot better. And again, spreading the focus out beyond, say, just can-do technology as it relates to the product and more into the other areas that I mentioned, I think would be very beneficial. Thank you.
Okay.
Why Canada? When I went to Hyperion, we started to look at everything from their technology choices, materials choices, and to what market were they focused on? Because you can't be all things to all people. And so we started to look around the world. where you had a combination of the infrastructure, the ability, capable manufacturers to make it, the educational base, the students, AECL, national laboratories like Chalk River, where you could get some things done there that you couldn't get done at a small private lab. And you said, there's a lot of driver. And the most important driver is Canada itself has the need. If you look at the north with the Arctic melting and the Northwest Passage open more and more of the year, and the need for the military to expand and go up there and do it, the First Nations, the power requirement. You look at the resource extraction of the oil sands and also of the gold mining, uranium mining in remote locations. Most of them are powered by diesel. And the diesel, like the Davik diamond mines, has to go up over thousands of miles on the ice road, which is now only open for 3 or 4 weeks a year. So clearly there needs to be a different solution. And a small modular reactor, an extremely small modular reactor, is about the right size. And so it can compete economically and favorably against large diesel. So about last summer, we realized this and we started coming to Canada, because with any nuclear technology, you need to get it licensed by a credible country first. And Canada also has a very credible regulatory infrastructure. So we started to come to Canada, as well as continuing with the United States, is how do we drive this innovation through the very, very conservative system and get it accepted on the other end.
Okay, so that's interesting, because I think that builds on a comment that was mentioned earlier today around letting the market decide on what's needed and how needs for larger scale may be changing in favor of needs for smaller scale. It's very interesting. Doug.
Okay, so I probably have a slightly different view, but I'll say my first thing first, which is I love Canada, and it's important. And I believe Canada has all the technologies necessary to pull off and commercialize what we're working on. And in fact, Canada has some specific ones, tritium handling and knowledge in that sort of neutronics, that are probably world leading. And I think we could lose those if we don't go. So the question is more about the overall support infrastructure. Does it work? So there is no fusion program in Canada. So I would say there's zero support. In fact, we've managed to get ahead without it. From the rest of it, which would be universities and science centers and even this industry, they're very slow. So we're a commercial entity that has to go. If we want to do something simple with a university and we would like the answer in 6 months' time, it takes a year to 18 months to actually set up the arrangement to do the work, which means they've cut themselves out. This industry as a whole is, you know, as I said earlier today, 30 years from the last build. An industry that moves on 30-year timescales is not fast enough to bring something forward. So even though I think we have all the technologies, it takes some other mandate or something to drive it forward. And I think it was touched on a little bit earlier today as well. Somebody has to make a decision to go. And if the country itself doesn't make the decision, it won't happen, and we'll lose the technology and the knowledge outside. And the topic this morning was the thorium and spent fuel rods in CANDU in China. Like, why weren't they done in Canada? There's something missing that we didn't take our technology and advance the world that way, which is something that the world has been clamoring for. So there's something about speed that's missing, and I think it's completely detrimental to this industry, and if the industry goes in a fusion way, the fusion industry overall. So.
Very cool, very interesting. Okay, so do you guys want to offer any comments to each other on the different perspectives you?
I don't think so. I agree with him. You know, but I think if you look at the industry we're in, you know, and the extreme amount of regulation, particularly post Chernobyl, post Three Mile Island, and post Fukushima, for whatever reason, you know, it's just going to take time, and the process itself is cumbersome, and there's a good reason for it, and you just have to acknowledge it, blend in with it, and, you know, go through the system.
I humbly disagree.
Good. That's why I said it that way.
Our regulation, we choose to be the way it is, and we choose to be that slow. It's something we choose to do. Other nations don't. they go faster. And the China story with thorium and spent fuel rods is exactly that. They made a decision to go, it was valuable to the country, and they went. Now, is it less safe? It's a good question. I don't know. We'll find out in 10, 15 years. But it could have been done here very quickly and likely very safely if we chose to do so. So I don't think we have the option of waiting around. I don't think we have the option of waiting around as a planet. I don't think we have an option of waiting around as a country. And I think the US has done the same thing. They're waiting around. And I think lots of technologies are going to go to other places and economies are going to change because we choose to wait. We're losing our innovation and we're losing our drive.
Yeah, and what I heard from you guys just now was market-driven. Someone needs to make clear direction.
Absolutely.
Someone's got to move forward, and that's, you know, there's some decisions around there. Michael?
Yeah, I was just going to say, Canada certainly has stature within the globe, but we're not, we just don't have the facilities and the wherewithal to take on every single new technology and really have an strong impact. So we are in the unfortunate position that we have to pick what we're going to work on. And I'm not saying that fusion is not something that we ought to do, but you may need to pick between one, maybe you have to pick between fission and fusion, I don't know, maybe there's not enough capacity for both. It goes back to even in the universities, what's being taught there and what kind of programs are available to develop the talent to support the kind of R&D and development work that you're looking for. And that applies to all of our industries. And it applies to all of the areas where you want to innovate. Can you do everything? Especially these larger scale ones, which requires a lot of resources, requires government support in many cases. And in order to do something, you're going to have to give something else up. Those issues have to be dealt with. They have to be dealt with quickly. I agree with that. But kind of the worst thing you can do, I think, is trying to peanut butter your efforts over a whole bunch of different areas, because then you don't do justice to anything at all. So again, I'm not suggesting fusion isn't something that should be on that list, but that's part of the analysis that has to be done before you move forward, I think.
Okay. So you mentioned, you know, unraveling some of these causes, and a couple of topics came up, which is a nice segue. In terms of some of the challenges facing innovation that at least you mentioned, is regulation. So what impact do you think the regulatory environment might have on innovation? Bob?
Well, you know, the regulatory environment is placed upon you by your government, right? Deciding that that's the right way to protect its citizens. And so you want to make sure it's perfectly safe and perfectly secure, and of course that's an additional issue with nuclear power, is the proliferation and the security issues. But what that comes with is a very regulated set of requirements that you have to meet and documentation you have to produce. And that's just the field in which you play, right? I mean, that's, yes. And we aren't gonna change that in the United States, or we're not gonna change it in Canada or the UK either. They have three different systems of regulation, but all very similar in certain ways. I think the United States tends to be a little more prescriptive. Someone described to me the difference between the regulatory system in Canada and in the United States. And he said that in the United States, it's like going to elementary school and you have a checklist and you check the boxes. And you have to get all the boxes checked, and they check, and they make sure you got it checked, and you're good to go. In Canada, it's like getting your PhD thesis. It has to have documentation that backs it up. You got to be able to prove it, but it's got to make sense. And for first of a kinds, that may be superior to the United States, and that's why the United States is very resistant at the NRC level to Gen 4 technology or technologies other than light water. Because that's what they know, and that's what the checklists are made out for. Well, in Canada, you have the opportunity, and because you're smaller, to be more fleet of foot, and you have an industry that's in transition. So I would think, and you also have a national need to have something to replace large-scale diesel and to reduce the amount of greenhouse gases generated getting oil out of oil sands. And so, I mean, I think Canada has a unique opportunity and advantage in the system that they chose to establish for regulation and their status of the country and where it's going, and how to maximize the extraction of the many resources that Canada has available.
Doug?
Okay, so we've engaged the CNSC. We produce neutrons with the work that we're doing. And I would say overall, they've been exceptionally helpful. We've been quite pleased. I was greatly worried about going there beforehand because of all the nightmare stories I've had, and that's not our experience to date. However, as we move down the commercialization path, fusion is not something that's in anybody's regulations. So the NRC in the US has a mandate, they say fusion's there, but they haven't actually done anything to do with the regulation. And in Canada, if you read the Act, it's a long read if you want to sleep, but one of the first paragraphs says that fusion and fission power plants will be treated the same as Class 1A, and that's the only reference. That alone could be a 10-year hurdle in multi-millions of dollars. So there has to be some innovation there if we want to move faster. Specific to the question about does regulation block or stifle innovation, I say absolutely. In the US, everything's light water. If you bring something else, you're at the end of the list, you will be stagnated there for, I think it's 15 years now before you even get your first little bump up the list. So people will change their technologies that they're approaching in order to fit a mandate that's easier to get regulation. So that absolutely stifles innovation. Likewise in Canada, most familiar in a fission world with CANDU or heavy water technologies. So again, you kind of get pigeonholed, depending on what country you're in, to what kind of technologies you can innovate in. And I think it kills. It kills a lot of ideas right from the very beginning. I think there's great US technologies in fission that are in the national labs, but they'll never get out for that single reason.
Right, so there's some two perspectives on new technologies, on advancing our existing ones.
It's a good question. Obviously, the regulatory regime, you want it to be efficient and you want it to be fast and fair. And you want it to reflect the safety needs of the components as being registered or whatever. I kind of see that. I think the point about each regulatory function tends to have skills in a certain area. So here in Canada, as you said, it's CANDU reactor. In the U.S., it tends to be more PWR or BWR. And you try to license a CANDU reactor in the US, it's very difficult to do that. You need special codes, et cetera, et cetera. Our experience on the SMR, we're going through the licensing process already in the US, and we started it here in Canada as well. And actually, quite surprisingly, perhaps, they're working together. And they will share results of reviews. They'll still retain independence because they're looking after the interests of their respective countries, but they will share that information with each other. And to me, that's kind of a breakthrough, if you like. I'm not sure they've ever done that before. The other thing I see is that the skill of the regulator, and I'm not talking about the skill of the organization as a whole, but more the individuals. And some of these people have never spent time in a nuclear plant, and they just don't have the familiarity. They're very, very book smart and numerically understand everything, but not necessarily are all that familiar with, you know, cause and effect. Well, we'd like you to do this. Well, here's the impact that might have with the plant, kind of thing. And I think what would be very healthy as a suggestion to go forward is if there was far more movement, rotation of people from a utility into, in our case, CNSC and out again. Just keep that movement going so you not only have people at plants that understand the regulatory regime and the things they have to do, but also you have within the CNSC people who understand how plants work. And I think that kind of thinking, very innovative thinking, I might add, may help the situation as well.
Okay, very good. So we've got some issues around regulation being tailored to a specific area, and even though it's tailored to a specific area, mm-hmm. you may have some talent issues, which raises the next question in terms of broader talent questions. Where do you get the talent required to keep the nuclear sector moving forward? How does it find it now, and where do you think you'll find it in the future?
Who are you looking at?
It'd be Doug.
Yeah.
So Canada stopped fusion, I think it was 1997, official slash and cut. And because of that, in Canada, fusion-specific scientists, with the exception of tritium handling and some of the materials things, are not here. So we have to go external. From a mechanical engineering, electrical engineering point of view, it's fine. Canada's got great schools and great people. My one comment would be, somewhere along the line, maybe it's because of Facebook and software or whatever the heck it happens to be, it's a world I don't understand, we're losing the sense of people who build things. And as a company who's predominantly doing a prototype, people don't know how to build things anymore. And one of our standard interview questions is, you know, which way does a screw turn? Like a real smart guy, no, seriously. And a real smart guy will say, is it a right hand or a left hand? Right? And the rest guess. So it's an issue that whatever our education has to be to build this talent and the experience that has to come, we have to get them out of computers and into the real world, and you touched on it with plant knowledge. Somewhere along the line, I think we're starting to lose that, and I think we have to get it back, or it'll go someplace else.
So Bob, your experience?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think
that the people is the secret, and it's the core of every endeavor, right? It's about the people. And in the case of nuclear power, you know, again, I'm in my 60s. And one of the reasons I came back to work was unless we came out with something, there weren't going to be people working anymore who saw the last ones to be built. And I think it's a international issue. It certainly is a grave issue in the United States. And I don't know Canada near as well as I hope to in the future, but it's about bringing along the next generation and don't have the best and brightest go to Wall Street, but have them go introduce nuclear power and fusion and hopefully generation four reactors as well, and to make it exciting and worthwhile and compensate them well for it. But I also think you need to get back with the universities, and that's one of the things that we've worked on, is to go try and link up with the universities in the United States and abroad that are working on lead bismuth technology. There's a lot going on in the world, and it has to be put together for coolants other than light water. And I think education, of course, is enhanced by driving technologies like nuclear power forward, whether it's fusion or fission. And we need to do that as countries. And it's a way to create a lot of great jobs.
Yeah, there's no question there's a concern here. All you have to do is look at your own companies or organizations like this, and you see that the average age is up quite a bit, and that trend's not going to slow down. In the past, we were fortunate in that we could, say 20, 30 years ago, we could bring in engineers more easily from other parts of the world. Actually, that's reversing now. These people are actually going back, so you almost have a reverse brain drain that way. So there's no question there's an issue, and there's lots of things that can be done. You know, you can have programs where you're reaching into schools more to show them what we do, make nuclear or mechanical engineering more of an attractive thing. Women are a big untapped resource at universities in terms of how many go into engineering. Even as your working population gets older, you have to start working on transition and sharing of information. How do you do that? You have to work on mentoring. You have to look at a tapered off retirement so that people aren't just closing the door one day and moving out. Instead, you have a longer term tapering off period so that technology information can get transferred more easily. So there's lots of things you can do. But the reality is that what we need to do is bring in more people. The comment about schools is very valid. I talk to kids and ask them what they want to do. If you give them a choice between going to work at a company like RIM or work like a company like Babcock or Wilcox, I mean, the technology we do is, in some ways, is far more significant, perhaps, than what you might do at RIM. But RIM sure seems like an exciting place to work. Maybe not so much now, but pretty exciting place. They bring in all sorts of bands for celebrations. They do lots of things and really cater to the younger people. And I think we need to change the way we hire people, make it more attractive to younger people to enter the workforce. So there's a lot of things to do. There's no question that there are issues and concerns, and whether we do it collectively or as individual companies, we have to do it. Because I know if we don't, we'll be left by the wayside. Every new job we have, if we're already fully staffed up, let's say, the biggest hurdle we have, the bottleneck, is engineering, always. My philosophy at B&W is that the only group that can be overstaffed is engineering for that reason. I want to make sure that it's never a bottleneck for new work, new development, fixing a problem, whatever it might be, because that's who does it. I guess in summary, I think we have to have our internal programs to help take advantage of the resources we do have, and there needs to be a far, far greater effort to look at how we can bring in new talent from the universities or elsewhere.
Okay, so we've got a couple things that got brought up there. A common view around the nuclear industry in general is the aging workforce and the access to people to execute, and coupling that with the different culture, maybe that's coming out of the education system, but the young people that look for the sexy stuff, not the not the stuff that's not as obvious to them. And that brings it back to the academic areas in terms of improving all of that, and might help with the innovation engine.
And it's also mechanical skills. You know, it's welders. Yeah. You know, welding a nuclear power plant or a steam generator, you know, is not like other welding. And as we are also stopping the defense programs for, you know, nuclear submarines, you're also losing that skill of the people that can do nuclear grade welding. So it's both engineers and technicians.
Yeah. Okay, so far we've talked about, you know, what's the current state of innovation in the power sector. We've talked about regulation, we've talked about talent. And one thing that Michael had mentioned earlier in your comments is you're not sure whether fission should be part of, you know, with fusion, should be part of the mix or not. So there's a big question there in terms of scale, in terms of direction of investment dollars, in terms of public support. Do large-scale innovation projects crowd out smaller ones? Michael, you want to comment on that?
Sure, just to correct, I don't want Doug to be mad at me here, so. No, I fusion may very well have to be the right thing for us to work on. It's just an example of, you know, whether it's pharmaceutical, no matter what industry, sometimes you have to focus your efforts in certain areas to be successful. And I can't really say whether, I happen to think fusion is the ultimate answer to our power problem, so I'd hate to see that go by the wayside. You know, scale innovation, I think I characterize these things based on their size and effort required. So, you know, you're developing a new reactor, regardless of what kind it is, whether it's fusion or a fission reactor, and it's meant to be the next generation, something different than what we've done before, an innovation, if you like. Something that size, I recall when ACL was developing the ACR 700. I recall the time it took Westinghouse to do the AP1000 and even the EPR, and how much we're spending on our own SMR at this point in time. These are hundreds of millions of dollars that you're basically in some ways betting the company on, because all of your resources, all of your cash sort of goes into that development. It's a big, big risk that companies generally are not likely to make, because you bet the company. So there is a role, I think, for government to step in and help. Particularly where, and my rationale for doing that too, is it's often those big innovations that have the most dramatic impact on the overall industry and can really move it forward. There was a time that nuclear plants weren't here, and there was a government, a strong government influence and government support for developing nuclear power. And it did do exactly what we just said. It moved Canada very much forward in this industry, and it's employed tens of, or maybe hundreds of thousands of people over the years. So those things are important. And then you go back down to lower levels, where perhaps it's just to put a number on it, maybe it's a $5 million R&D program to develop a new product or new widget to do this better. I don't think you need government support for that. These are all kind of relative numbers, I realize that, but that's, at least in our company, that's the way we would see it. But there have to be, you know, what drives is competition. It's a dog-eat-dog world out there, as most of you know, and there's somebody out there, whether they're in China, Japan, our next-door neighbor, whatever it is, that are eager to take our business. And so we're driven by the need to always do better, and that's what innovation does for us. So we'll put our own money into things like that, because we have to, because if we don't, we won't survive. The same thing with changes, not just to products, but also to you know, systems that we use, the processes. We have a very elaborate, well, not elaborate, we have a very, I think, an OPEX program that spans our entire business, operational excellence. And using that program, it really allows us to look at processes and improve those processes, reduce cost, et cetera. That, to me, that's an innovative approach to improving your business. So I guess to summarize, there is a scale issue, and with that scale issue comes the need for government support. The bigger projects that I think that ITER is a great example of a large project for fusion, where it's not just a government, it's multiple governments, multiple countries involved in order to move the technology a big step ahead. So if that doesn't if that ever does happen, it will be a major breakthrough, I think, for the fusion program. And the same thing occurs in the fission areas as well, whether it's, you know, developing an SMR reactor or whatever it may be. And then the lower level ones, I think those are the kind of ones that, at least I view, that you handle yourself. There's also one other aspect to all this too, is collaboration with other companies to spread the risk, because it's all about risk. I talked about risking the company on a big effort. You can share that by collaborating with us, and that's not unusual. We see on the ATMIA project, for example, I mean, that's a collaboration between MHI and Areva working together, and we see that all the time as well. So that's a part of it, in my view.
Yeah. Doug?
Okay, so I took the question more from a government-funded, big center type concept. And specifically on the ITER thing, which is interesting. And for those of you that don't know ITER, it's a $20 to $30 billion project being built in the south of France. Canada was involved at one point and there got out about 19 or 2003. But because it's so large and internationally funded, it sucks most of the money. So I'll give the example of the US. The US currently, they have about a $400 million fusion for energy budget. And I think this year, 120 went to ITER, their funding contribution to ITER, which leaves about, you know, 300 million or so for the domestic programs. Next year, I think it's 200 million, and in 2 years' time, it's 300 million go to ITER. And they're not expanding the budget for fusion for energy. So what happens is a domestic program gets chopped, and it will be chopped by 75% by the time they're done, to the point that they're now closing the domestic sort of facilities in order to continue the funding. So from my perspective, what this does is kills any sort of, kill may be too strong of a word, strongly damages the US's ability to now compete in this fusion technology if it eventually does take off. And it fundamentally goes to the countries that are hungrier. And I completely agree with you, it's a dog-eat-dog world, and there are other countries that are hungrier, and they will take over this technology. So then you have to find out which part you play in it. And if I tie that back into Canada, with the selling of AECL, we now have Chalk River Labs. So what are key aspects there? If fusion is going to happen, and I mentioned it earlier, Canada has some really key technologies. No matter where fusion happens, those technologies are required. Yet nobody in the world is really working on them yet, because this project isn't going to come to fruition until about 2026. So there's yet a decade before it really becomes a problem, and it may not become a problem for another 10 years after that. If we're successful, it becomes a problem right away. But these technologies are key, and Canada can make a decision to go into them and maintain that technology. So I think you need some aspect of centralization, but very large projects mean you make a choice and you choose one and everything else suffers. And even in the US, that $100 million that's left for the domestic fusion program all has to be in support of ITER. So anything that's innovative or different is actually cut. And this year, the cuts to the innovative stuff was 50%, and next year it'll probably be another 50%, and then it's gone. And those type of projects never come back. Now, we revised one. We took one from 1976 that got chopped down to nothing, and we revised it. And these technologies are actually quite viable and very interesting if you put some effort into them.
Interesting. Your perspective, Bob?
Well, yeah, this is sort of an internal Canada perspective, but I can look from, you know, our technology came out of the Los Alamos National Laboratory. And if that were just in the private sector, it would not have. And every national laboratory in the United States has some kind of program sponsoring some type of research for advanced reactors. And industry just doesn't have the money. You can't do it. You have to make a profit. So, and if you look at something that's long lead time and big and highly regulated, like nuclear fuel, and the validation and qualification of nuclear fuel, you need to have a reactor to irradiate the fuel and then do all the testing on it. Well, the United States, those are in Idaho at that national lab, or they're at Argonne, or they're at Oak Ridge. That's the only places you could do it. Here in Canada, of course, you got Chalk River. And so Chalk River becomes a very important national resource to sustain and keep going. You know, as I started to look at Hyperion, you know, it's venture back. So you say, well, where's the intellectual property? What's the investor investing in? And the real reality that started to hit me was there's not much. You have a pretty loose hold on intellectual property. Well, why is that so? Is it any different for us than anybody else? The answer is no. It's because most nuclear stuff was done by governments. So there's prior art. So what you really have to get through to is you have to get through that valley of death through a license from a credible country. And so it's very important in this industry that we support each other through that. But I think the existence of national laboratories that can house these very expensive resources, supported by Stanford and MIT and UNLV and other universities, very definitely play an important role in continued innovation in the nuclear field.
Very good. So that's an interesting couple of perspectives. If I'm gonna,
could I comment on that one?
Absolutely.
Just for fun. Yeah. When there's an issue with science overall, and it pertains to Canada and to the U.S., it has become political. So this is a really nasty thing that goes on. So when you talk about those national labs, they're all playing off each other, all trying to get their piece ahead of everybody else, and it's not collaborative.
Oh, no, not at all.
You know, if you want dog-eat-dog, go to the intellectual or the university-type things and grant applications. That's dog-eat-dog. Business is nothing compared to that, as far as I can tell.
Okay. There's some truth in that.
There we go. Okay, so one theme that I just like to just bring out that I think I heard from panel members is a role of national laboratories can play an important role because it seeds some ideas. We also heard that says if you get too much focus in a particular sector, then you stop being able to expand outside of a particular technology niche. That was kind of the example you mentioned about the ITER funding that's going to be focusing more and more on the international program. That could result in closures, which could then hurt the ability for the nation to serve the community, even academia. So I thought that was an interesting perspective around that. Before you respond to that comment, I want to bridge into some additional questions that have come from the social media. And the first one that I've been given is, what do you think may be other large barriers to innovation in the country? We've already talked about regulation, we've already talked about talent, we talked about scale, and then I just made this observation around the focus that could have consequence. Who wants to start dealing with that? Michael?
Yeah, other barriers to innovation, some we've sort of touched on, but you know, when I think of the broad category of innovation, I kind of think of people. It's people that actually innovate. It's not machines, it's not computers, it's people. And so are we teaching those people in the right way? Are we giving them the opportunity? And you know, when I went through university, I can't remember ever having a course on innovation. So whether we need to have a course like that or something, I'm not sure. But there's probably something missing out of the school system that could help be helpful for that. So to me, that the stock of ideas that are there, largely are coming from the younger people, and if they're not equipped to sort of address them or deal with them or come up with them, I think that's a problem. The other thing that is a barrier, and this is maybe not, it's a large scale, small scale, but I see it in our company all the time, and you've heard the term reinvent the wheel, and it's true. When you reinvent the wheel, you're solving a problem that's been solved before. And the challenge for us is to recognize that before we do all the work to solve that problem. and to hold on to information, whether it's an innovation such as how to deal with a situation, how to store that and retrieve it for use later on is always a challenge for us. Our IT systems just aren't really built all that well for that. And I'm sure that we'll see improvement. But I see that as a kind of a barrier for innovation because we are spending a lot of time doing the same thing over and over again. And maybe collaborative type approaches or open, sort of open text type approaches where information is more freely shared would obviously move us further down that direction. The other barrier to innovation that I see is the groupthink. How often does that really happen? Most good ideas, I think, despite some of the early comments, do come from a group of people talking about something. You build on each other's ideas, and before you know it, you've got an innovative idea. So to the extent that that happens, I know that in the school system is now starting to do more of that, and certainly in business, that's kind of mandatory. When you have an issue, you deal with it as a group as opposed to as an individual. But the more of that we do collaborate, I think that the better ideas and better innovations will arrive out of that. And then the last point I would make in terms of the barrier is it's kind of that, I think the point's been made about speed, but also, having the idea is only a very small part of it. Having that innovative approach, it's moving it to the next level. It's commercializing it or implementing it in some way. And actually, I think that's the area that we fail the most. We just don't seem to get these ideas. It's a common, sort of commonly held belief, whether it's true or not, I don't know, that most of the Japanese devices, etc., are usually invented here in North America. They just are better at commercializing things than we are. So, I think that there's probably something more we need to do on that front as well. So,
Bob?
Yeah, I was trying to think. Part of it's the short-term focus of human beings, younger people with the texting and all the stuff, that the long-term attention span to really come up with something in our business in nuclear. Whether it's on the waste business or on the front end, on small and modular reactors or what have you, takes time because it's a regimented, regulated, and properly so process. What we're doing with can also hurt people, and it can also have people misuse it for the purposes like Iran is in the news every day about, right? So we have to be thoughtful, and we have to be meticulous, and it has to be structured. But so it's not instant gratification, it's long-term thinking. And I think, if you look at the economy on Wall Street, in the Wall Street, the super huge bonuses for Wall Street and stuff like that, and sucking up the best and the brightest engineering students to work on Wall Street instead of as engineers, I think those are real issues and real problems. And I think they're social media issues, and they are social problems that we can solve. But I think we can solve by being relentless and have the resolve to drive forward fusion, have the resolve to try at Gen 4 reactors and not be satisfied with Gen 3 or Gen 3 plus. We can do better. And I think it's up to the people in this room to keep driving that in their own respective arenas.
Okay, so I agree with everything they said on both counts there. And specifically the aspect of this, which drives me nuts. And it's even to the news. Like, somebody show me something that's good with news today, something that's informational. Your typical bite is, 30 seconds or 20 seconds, and commercials do the same thing. It drives all the way down to venture capital financing. If you can't turn a company from zero to a billion in 18 months, there's something wrong, and it's a bad investment. So everything's been driven to this really quick, short time frames. Wall Street is another example. At one point, somebody told me that 50% of the U.S. GDP was financial instruments from Wall Street.
Right.
My God, that produced nothing, right? But it's this instant gratification and turn of money or whatever it happens to be. And I think it's pretty much sucking the lifeblood out of North America. Maybe too strongly stated, but I don't think that's happening in other countries and economies. And then I will put one positive thing from what you said, which was reinventing the wheel. best tool ever by far that I've seen in the last 10 years is Google, right? There is a tool that you can find pretty much anything you want. If you want to find out if some guy did something in 1957 in Tennessee, Google will usually pop it up, and it's unbelievable what they find, and that saves industry today, I bet you 25% overall on that type of stuff. So there is some of that social internet stuff, one good thing.
Okay.
Google.
How about Apple?
So there's a couple of thoughts there. You talked about collaboration. We all talked about the attention span. You referred to the social media. So the last question from the social media links that they've got is, do you think greater access in the workplace to social media tools and online information sharing would increase the potential to innovate with peers across the industry? So Mike, you want to handle that?
Yeah, that's a tough one. You know, intellectually, I fully agree with that. The more ideas are shared, the more knowledge is going to be generated, if you know what I mean, more ideas are going to come out. And the other side of that, of course, is protection of IP. That's always the challenge between those two ideal situations. So I would say yes, there's certainly a room for some sort of more collaboration on an uncontrolled basis. As a company, you're going to have to accept the risk that IP will be shared. I must admit, we haven't done it yet ourselves in that way. And some parts of what we do, some parts of our businesses will be less likely to do it, but I think some parts would. And I would like to, you know, see it implemented sort of in a small scale version first and just to see how it goes. But social media has far more things and benefits than just that, though. It's not just about sharing ideas. It's about talking about what's going on. It's your coffee shop, right? Talking about that boss that you've got and you know, how terrible he is, and you need to get somebody new. It's just about talking about the business and what's happening. So while there may be some benefit to collaboration on a technical end of things, I think there's far more that you get out of that social media than just doing that as well.
You certainly can't avoid it. You know, I was the last 3 years I was CEO, Yahoo was a dominant influence, and they had the Yahoo Finance blogs, and anybody can write anything in there, right? And matter of fact, you had to read it because you had to know it was there, but you couldn't answer one single one, right? Or then you had to answer every one of them because of Sarbanes-Oxley and the regulation. So you just read it, and the good ones were wrong, and so were the bad ones, right? And but you had to stay informed. But that's a big time waster. You know, if you look at innovation, we hire people that work 40 hours a week or more, and they've got a lot to do, I hope, right, to advance us and to move what we're trying to do as a company forward. And you certainly don't want them spending their time at work on social media. And so, but how do you regulate that without stifling? And I think that's a big challenge to companies today, and I'm glad I didn't have it.
And Doug?
Man, I'm feeling old. So, internal to the company, completely agree, collaboration is key. You have to bring people together, you have to drive them to share their ideas, and you have to share them and force them to make mistakes. And I'll give you an example. In some of the work we were doing, we were trying to ramp up something to some velocity, and everyone was worried that it would break. And it took them 3 months before it broke. And I looked at them and said, you could have broken that on the second day and we would have known. Right? So there is a fear of failure, which you have to overcome if you want to innovate. Yeah. Collaboration is great. Now, to the social media, which to me means Facebook and Twitter, I think is the thing, I would be appalled if it was going on lots in the company. One, it could be a leak of IP. Two, people are sharing stuff that probably they shouldn't, and it gives outside access. And then this is going to be for the young people here that are looking for jobs. I have not hired a person because of what they tweeted, because it just made no sense to me that a rational person could tweet such things, right? It's your reflection of who you are and how you interact with the world, and it's out there for everybody to find. If I, you know, give me your name, I'll Google it, and if you're tweeting, I find it. What you ate for breakfast, you know, what jeans you wear, if your underwear bunched up, whatever the heck it happened to be, right? It's all there. So I would say be cautious. Like, I think it's interesting, but I think it's actually an overall detriment sometimes, and it brings us back to that fast, instant, lots of information, but no real good information.
Very good. So I think those are the questions that we had prepared to pose to the panel, and now it's the time for you guys out there to ask some questions that may be on your minds that they haven't addressed. So the microphones. We got three hands. There we go. Man in front.
Yeah, I have a couple items. One is...
Oh, before, if you want to direct the question, at one of the panel members, okay. that would be fine.
Actually, I can address this to all of them, and then I have one comment. The question really is, how do you establish a stable, long-term strategic plan for innovation in science and technology when you're working in a government environment that pretty much has a time horizon as the next election? I think that's a real impediment, and I'd like to hear comments on it. The other thing I want to talk about was the groupthink thing, because while it can be very valuable, it can also stifle innovation, because the individual who has a different idea can be intimidated against bringing it out because of not wanting to break that groupthink thing.
Okay, so the question is how to establish a long-term strategic plan in the context, right, by government in the context of elections. Anybody want to handle that first?
I think it's the thing that's killing us. I think government no longer makes decisions for the betterment or long-term. They make it, do I get reelected, and usually 2 or 3 years, and I think it's a tragedy, actually, both provincially and federally. And it's just not a good thing, and that's our fault. And I would say because we allow it as voters, and stuff like Kyoto and any of the greenhouse gas stuff, we allow it to drop out and not participate and whatever, and there's no punishment for doing so, which is odd for me. So, and as to bringing out the voice, the internal voices, you have to have people that are willing to be challenged, and it is really hard because you have bright, smart people that don't ever like to be challenged, but they're bright and smart. So somehow you have to either talk to them privately and get somebody else to bring their thing up and find a way to draw the information. It's challenging.
Any other comments?
Yeah, I could offer one, because I think strategic planning is critical. And it doesn't really matter what the time horizon is. Strategic planning is about making choices. You know, I've got the resources to do this, and not the resources to do that, and certainly not the resources doing both together, right? So it's about making timely decisions on how you're going to allocate your most precious things. One is money, but the second, even more important, is the people and their brains. And as Dr. Fran Harvey, who was vice chairman of the board at Duratec, and as former the chief operating officer of Westinghouse, said that strategic planning without implementation is hallucination. And I think he was absolutely right.
So to expand on that, strategic planning that involves counting on the government will stay in power is not a strategic plan. It's a wish and a hope.
It's a wish, yeah.
Very interesting. And the next question, the gentleman in front.
Great topic, gentlemen. I've raised venture capital money in Canada and in the U.S. And, three of you up there represent businesses of three different sizes. And one is past venture capital, one has large venture capital, and one has, relatively small venture capital investment. What can the government do, specifically here in Canada, to create an environment to allow you to bet your company, or to underwrite you betting your company so that your shareholders don't start talking to the board about getting a new CEO?
Okay.
Hard to know about the CEO question, but one of the programs I really like in Canada is SABC. And I like it from a taxpayer perspective more than a CEO perspective. They give you money, and they require you to go out and find matching funds, wherever it happens to be. So it requires that you have industry participation. It requires that you have a consortium that will give a higher likelihood of success. There's got to be people involved that want the project to carry on. So for us, we've turned $6 million in from SEDC into $32 million in external financing. And as a taxpayer, I'd say, you know, 5-1 is pretty darn good. I'm happy with that. Right? It makes sense to me. So government creating more of these type programs where funds get matched to external money coming in is fantastic. I think there should be more of that.
Yeah. Bob, from U.S. perspective?
I mean, it's the same general theme, right? That, you know, one of the disadvantages for national laboratories and universities is they get disconnected naturally from what industry wants, what people want, what the public needs, right? And by tying commercial partners to national labs or universities, it helps draw it out into the public and into the system. And matching funds is a great motivator for both sides. And I think that that keeps the goals aligned. And I think it's very powerful.
Yeah, actually, I'm not sure I fully understood your question, but just to talk about the topic of raising money and how do you get financing, it's hard to do in some cases. I think that there's always a need to have a stake in it yourself. I think it's going to be kind of hard to get funding if you're not willing to put something of yourself into it as well, whether it's all your IP or your own cash or whatever it is. So that's certainly one of the ingredients to having any reasonable deal, I would say. The other thing that's absolutely necessary is a plan. And we talked about a strategic plan. You need to have a plan. It's just like getting a loan from a bank, right? You have to have a plan to demonstrate how you're going to use that capital, what the payback's going to be, and what the timing is going to be, and what your off-ramps might be as well. And I think that those kind of tools work just as effectively whether you're going to a government organization or to a private venture capitalist or going to a bank to help get funding. Those are just sort of the basics that come to mind. I would say that many companies are reluctant, many established countries, companies are reluctant to go to venture capitalists for kind of, and they generally go there because they feel they have no choice. It's the only source of capital that they can get. So that's kind of the way I look at that.
Okay. I would say venture capital is the most expensive capital you'll ever get.
So that's why people,
it's painful, as you
probably
know.
Well, it's got the highest risk as well, so, yeah.
Okay, I saw another hand for a question on this side. John? Oh, there we go.
This is for each of the panelists. In one line, what would you need to succeed?
I couldn't understand. Speak louder.
With one line, what do you need to succeed?
Oh, yeah. The laws of physics to behave as I expect them to.
Winning lottery ticket.
That sounds good.
There you go. I'll go with that answer.
Yeah. Presumably, you're talking about in the field of innovation. What one thing would to me, it still always comes back to people. It's people that really make it work. You can have whatever program systems in place that you want, but if you have to have the right people who have that mindset, and it's up to management to give them the environment that allows them to innovate. That's really the way I see it. So people is the most important thing.
Good. One more. Yeah, there's someone over here. Oh, we got someone over there. I'm sorry, I didn't see that. Hang on, we have someone in the corner. He's already got a mic.
Yes. I just want to make one comment here, kind of throw it open to the field. It's a little surprising to me in a discussion on innovation at this particular time that no one has made reference to Steve Jobs and that we lost Steve Jobs over the last year. And something was said just at the tail end of the discussion I think is really critical. The expression was used, fear of failure. Now, if you look at the Steve Jobs culture within Apple, Steve Jobs would have been very proud to tell you that he's probably the world leader in failures. It was somewhere, something between Steve Jobs or Thomas Edison was the world leader in failures. But look at the results. You have to be willing to fail. And you have to be willing to take chances. The thing that made Apple so successful under Steve Jobs was they went through lots of ideas, lots of failures, and they would analyze where they were and quickly realize what was going to work and what wasn't. They threw out dozens and dozens and dozens, probably hundreds of products that were on the drawing board and just weren't going to make it, but they were willing to accept that they were failures, and they had this relentless drive to set those aside and continue on with the ones that work. And that's how you make innovation work.
Okay, so is there a question for the panel in there?
Question for the panel is, do you buy into that as a process?
Mike? I certainly, Jim, that's part of it. Even the R&D tax credit programs are built so that they're pushing towards things that may not be successful. That's just the way they work. So they don't want to pay money for things you know are going to work, if you know what I mean. So the idea of things failing, I agree with you. I wouldn't say, though, that I wouldn't characterize it quite so that they had a failure, so they threw it out. I think they had a failure and then they tried a different approach, because Jobs was very focused on the product he wanted, very, very focused on that. And so the idea of failure during the development phase, you're right, I think he would take different tracks and do things. But I always thought that Jobs was extremely focused on getting that product done. So
I was reading Steve Jobs' book, the autobiography, on my way up on my iPad. And so you ring a bell. But I think there's a big difference in Steve Jobs before he got fired the first time and when he came back. He knocked off a lot of edges. And I think the thing that was interesting to me was he never did any market studies or looked at what the customer wanted. It was his personal constant obsession with making products that were insanely great. But it's insanely great as defined by Steve Jobs. And it's a great read if you haven't read it. It's certainly worth doing. But there sure was a difference in Steve Jobs when he first was at Apple, then he got fired, and then when he came back.
Yeah. So General Fusion is attempting to do fusion for a few tens of millions of dollars financed by VC in a country that doesn't do fusion. We're okay with failure. From doing multiple prototypes until you get it right, it's easy to do if your prototype's $100. It's not so easy if your prototype is $10 million and you only have $5 million in the bank. So certain cultures work well depending on what they're trying to commercialize a product. In the nuclear industry, I can't imagine $10 billion plants built and nine of them fail. I don't think that would go. So I think you have to tailor that response to the industry and the scale of the industry that you're working in.
Very good.
In Canada, we have some very interesting experience with small reactors. That was the topic we talked about. We had the maple reactor, mm-hmm. and there were some very expensive lessons learned. There's a lot of risks. If there's errors, it's very expensive to fix it. If the fuel isn't right or the geometry isn't right, you can't just throw out the fuel and put in another load and fix it and keep going. The other requirement is you analyze things, and the maple reactor was analyzed very carefully using the best codes we had. And then it was reviewed by Brookhaven National Labs and Idaho National Labs, and we even sent it to a competitor in Argentina, NASA, and they reviewed it. And they said there was nothing wrong with the model, but when we actually built it, it had a positive power coefficient. And the regulator came back and said, well, you can't really operate in an unanalyzed state. So even though you may wanted to relicense it on the basis of a positive power coefficient, there were issues there.
Yeah, there were issues.
And so
you know, there's been a lot of experience with small reactors. You've used them in space on certain probes that went far, far away, and some of them are still operating, I think. And of course, the Naval Reactors Program was also with small reactors, and that took many years to perfect. And the Russians have a lot of interesting experience, and they're building small reactors, they're putting them on barges, and so there's a competitor there. And the Koreans have what they call the smart small reactor, and they've got the government 100% behind that, funding them right up to the hilt and making sure that it succeeds. So it makes it kind of difficult in Canada to be very innovative with small reactors.
So is there a question for the panel on that?
Well, I just wanted to inject a bit of experience, because like, we were talking about there's a lot of gray matter here, and we have these young people here who are getting fired up to go to build innovative small reactors. We've had some very important lessons in Canada that have to be learned, studied, analyzed before we charge off to take new risks, because it's very difficult to fix an error when you have irradiated fuel.
Yeah, actually, I'd like to comment on what you said. You're absolutely right. And I haven't talked too much about the B&W SMR, but one of the very important aspects of the design process is that we're taking advantage of everything that's already been done. So it's a PWR. The fuel assembly is the same assembly we use in normal PWRs, except half the height. So you know, we're not trying to do something different than what's already there. In terms of how the individual components work, the once through steam generator, the pressurizer, the reactor itself, it's all the same as already been done. Uses light water, uses enriched fuel, it's all the same. So that point is very valid in that there's a risk associated with innovating and coming up with a new product, a very, very big risk. And the time it takes you to overcome those risks just expands this commercialization time frame as well. So our approach was to take advantage of every existing technology that worked well and use it in the SMR. Materials, configurations, everything we could. And we believe that that does two things. One, it helps us from a licensing point of view. Two, it significantly reduces the risk on that first unit, as you have talked about. And also, it controls our costs as well. So there is a time, I guess what that, the point that brings up is there's a time to not innovate as well. So innovation for the sake of innovation may not always be the best approach. Innovation is there to solve a problem or make something better. It's not there to simply change for the sake of change.
I'll take that on. The approach that B&W is taking is to be applauded, without a doubt. But that's incrementalism, right? And they set out to build a great small modular reactor, right, that takes advantage of being as close to what exists as possible. And that's a great idea. But that's not that's not innovation, right? The innovation is go back to basics. Look at the physics. Hey, is fusion really possible? Can you really do it? Somebody's got to try it, right? That is, as the reactors get smaller, the light water is not the right coolant, right? You want to make them smaller, you want higher power density, better thermal characteristics. You want liquid metal, okay? Go through those. What are those? Someone has to try it, right? It's time to move to generation 4. We can be safer. We don't need 3 days without loss of power when you can do 30, right? All passive. So I think you need both. You need people like Doug who are willing to step right out there and go after it. And he deserves all the support in the world. And yet you also need people like B&W who meticulously left foot, right foot, left foot, right foot, build on 50 years of experience, 60 years of experience, doing submarines and light water reactors. And they're going to do a great job. right? But I also think you need other people that are trying to force the system, move it forward, move the technology forward. Our kids deserve both.
Okay, and if I can kick that can too, and this is for the students,
yeah,
because as we all agree, they're kind of the future of this industry. If you do a code and shows you something, the code is only good as the guy that wrote it, and the out part is only as good as the guy who put the parameters into it. And I bet you it's wrong. This is why stuff falls down. This is why that didn't work. The National Ignition Facility in the US is a $6 billion experiment to verify the codes they use for weapons. $6 billion just to verify the code. I would say the Maple reactor in some ways was, I think it was $800 million experiment to show that the code didn't work. Right? You could look at it from a different perspective, so you need better codes or better understanding. But if you start getting into like trusting your codes, you're in trouble. In our company, everything we do has codes in parallel, and then we build the experiment to see if it actually does the same thing. And you don't really trust one or the other. They have to be developed in tandem. And that's something to learn here, especially in something that's highly regulatory, and in fission especially, highly bad if things go wrong.
Yes, you have the microphone.
Hi. Push the button. All right. Hi, my name's Josh from U of T. I'm a student there. So I agree with what Apple does, and they're innovating and basically doing good science. And I think that nuclear should do the same thing. Now, taking it back to fusion, and there's two questions here. I guess my question is, why do we want to keep it in Canada? Now, I know that there's probably a really easy answer to that, that it makes good business, but perhaps it's better to put something like this in a more global perspective. If you think about something like the LHC in Geneva, that brings to mind beautiful pictures of science doing what science does. And maybe we should do the same thing with fusion. If it's going to be the ultimate answer, we don't want to have it segregated across all these different countries. We want to have the smartest people in the world working on this. So I guess maybe one solution would be to send Canada's smartest people there instead of, you know, investing in companies and privatization here in Canada. So I guess one question for Doug, since you have a history with business opportunities, and you know, you're probably the best person to answer this, but anyone else, feel free. What would be the approach that you would take to get Canada more involved with the international system? And then the second question is for Doug, are you hiring?
So it's an interesting. So why do I want to keep it in Canada? Because I'm Canadian, and I think it can be done in Canada, and I have my family here and everything else. I think we can do great things. Is it the right economic decision to keep it in Canada? My guess would be not. So it's more a wish and will of mine than what will likely be the outcome. I think the outcome will be it will go somewhere else and work on another country. Who's hungrier? I think this is what will eventually happen. With respect to putting the biggest and brightest, or shortest and brightest, I guess size should be out of it, to working on fusion, it's already happening. Like the ITER project that he mentioned, which is $30 billion, will have like 3,000 scientists all working on it. But it's one way, right? It's only one way, which is a large magnetic donut, and the National Ignition Facility and the laser guys are doing something else. The issue I have with that is I think they're going the wrong way. And you touched on it a little bit. It is now a large science project. I don't want a large science project. I want an engineering project that will bring products that bring energy to the planet. And you have to move away from science, which is study for the sake of science, to engineer it for the sake of products. And I think ITER, which actually stands for the way, has actually lost their way. And I think they have to pull it back. And are we hiring? Yes, all the time, for the best and brightest. And if you know plasma physics, then come talk to me.
Very good. Okay, so one more question. You've asked one already, this gentleman in the front. I think that's the only other hand I see.
I'm not sure whether this is a question or more of a comment. I suggest that you don't need, for innovation, you don't need to throw piles of money at it. You have to have bright people with the, with new ideas who are not restricted in the thing. And I'll go back to one of the things that just was mentioned at the beginning of this conference, the beginning of the CANDO program 50 years ago, almost to the day. The conception, conceptual design of the first CANDO type of reactor was put together by a team that would never exceeded 50 people and was done in less than a year. And that created the pressure tube concept, the on-power control, and most importantly, the fueling machine design. And the essence of that fueling machine design is still being used today. And that was all done, as I say, with a small team of just bright people, and by that way, young people. There wasn't anybody over the age of 40 in the group and so forth.
Yeah. I agree with you.
I agree with you.
Me too.
So
me too.
The problem with innovation and money is you need money to commercialize. It's not the innovation that costs the money. It's the commercialization that costs the money. There, so we're doing a project, 60 people, to take on fusion. It's the same. Now, we're 3 years rather than 1 year, you know, but the young people today, I've already said, aren't as good as the old people, so, you know.
they're too busy doing it.
There we go. All right. Okay, Marc, thank you.
You're
done? Okay.
All right, how about a hand for our panel? Thank you, Doug, Bob, Mike.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thanks to Marc for being such a great moderator.